Ladies and gentlemen, welcome to Time Tunnel TV. We have some tasty treats for you today, a guest that many of us wanted to see, two brilliant performances and some great news. So get comfy, sit back and enjoy the show.
Shot, one opportunity to seize everything you ever wanted in one moment that you captured. Just let it slip. Yo. His palms are sweaty, knees weak, arms are heavy. There's vomit on his sweater already. Mom's spaghetti, he's nervous, but on the surface he looks calm and ready to drop bombs. But he keeps on forgetting what he wrote down. The whole crowd goes so loud, he opens his mouth, but the words won't come out. He's choking how? Everybody's choking now. The clock's run out, time's up, over, plow. Snap back to reality, oh, there goes gravity. Oh, there goes gravity, choke. He's so mad, but he won't give up. Daddies, he know he won't have it. He knows his whole back to these ropes. It don't matter, he's dope. He knows that, but he's broke. He's so stagnant, he knows when he goes back to this mobile home. When it's back to the lab again, yo, this old rhapsody better go capture this moment and hope it don't do it. Lose his mouth in the music the moment you own it. You better never let it go. You only get one shot, do not miss your chance to blow. This opportunity comes once in a lifetime. You better lose his mouth in the music the moment you own it. You better never let it go. You only get one shot, do not miss your chance to blow. This opportunity comes once in a lifetime. You better so this hole that is gaping. This world is mine for the taking. Make me king as we move toward a new world order. A normal life is boring, but superstardom's close to postmortem. It only grows harder, homie grows hotter. He blows, it's all over. These hoes is all on him. Coast to coast shows, he's known as the Globetrotter. Lonely roads, God only knows he's grown farther from home. He's no father. He goes home and barely knows his own daughter. But hold your nose, cause here goes the cold.
Fucking roof off like two dogs cage. I was playing in the beginning, the mood all changed. I've been chewed up and spit out and booed off stage. But I kept priming and stepped right in the next cipher. Best believe somebody's paying the Pied Piper. All the pain inside amplified by the fact that I can't get by with my 9 to 5. And I can't provide the right type of life for my family. Cause man, these goddamn food stamps don't buy diapers. And it's no movie, there's no Mackay Pfeiffer. This is my life and these times are so hard. And it's getting even harder trying to feed and water my seed. Plus, see the thought I caught up between being a father and a prima donna. Baby mama's rhyme is screaming.
Yes, indeed. Yes. What a brilliant performance, and thank you for that. Okay, now you're thinking, well, let's cut the rubbish. We want to see the guest. And yes, ladies and gentlemen, we're about to find out in this VT, so please sit back and be patient and enjoy to uncover our...
It would be better if you gave me nothing at all. This album is less than nothing. I can't sell this. You're rapping about homosexuals and Vicodin. I can't sell this. But either change the record or it's not coming out.
This song is for anyone.
Jaws all on the floor like Pam, like Tommy just burst in the door. We started whooping her ass first than before. They first were divorced, sewing her over furniture. Ah! It's the return of the... Oh, wait, no, wait, you're kidding. He didn't just say what I think he did, did he?
Stanley, open the door.
What?
Stanley, what are you doing to yourself?
What the hell, you don't like it?
Stanley!
Like it?
Stanley!
Don't! Call me that! Don't call me that!
Why are you saying you're taking this too far?
Through freestyle rap battles to top chart music, Eminem has always ruled hip-hop and has been an idol to many.
From a gay broke bitch yourself, eh, Lope? This guy's doo-doo. You've worked here longer than me, and I get paid more than you do.
Serious, man.
Dog, take a seat. What's this guy standing in line for? He ain't got money to eat. Check this out. Yo, this guy cashed his whole check and bought one ho-ho. Fucking homo, little maggot. You can't hack it. Paul's gay. You're a faggot. At least he admits it. Don't even risk it. This guy's starving to death. Someone get him a biscuit. I don't know what they told you, Mike. You must have them cornrows rolled too tight. His job, you want to quit, but you can't. You worked at this plant so long, you're a plant. Look at your goddamn boots. For Christ's sakes, they're starting to grow roots. On this mic, you get faded. You look like a pissed off rapper who never made it. And why you fucking with the gay guy, G? When really you're the one who's got the HIV. Man, I'm done with this clown. He's soft. Fuck it. I'll let home
grow. Right, here we go. Sorry, I was just getting that wrapped up in that. But, well, anyway, we're going to inform you who's on today's show. Of course, it's the best white hip-hop star of today, the incredible Eminem. So...
Hello.
Glad you could meet us today. Well done. Sorry about that. I was getting very encapsulated with the
VT
there.
I was too. It was a very nice recollection of everything I've done so far.
Well, actually, that's the up-and-coming film that you played as the track that we've not heard before. It's been debuted here today because, obviously, current single Stand from the Marshall Mathers LP, your second LP. But how it started is pretty much how it was there, isn't it? The rap battles, and Dr. Dre actually sort of discovered you while you were doing these rap battles. I mean, how intense were they?
The rap battle scene is really, really intense, really, really very underground, and not many people know about it unless you're from the area that it comes from. So to be spotted from something like that and to be brought up to releasing a debut album that's apparently going to hit large, I don't know how true that is. Dr. Dre is going to hit large, so I'm hoping great things from it.
I mean, you can just be imagining like being an American football star and you're playing on a bit of broken ground and there's a couple of scouts watching it. It was very, very similar to that. But these rap battles, obviously, there's a couple of people shouting these obscenities at each other. You don't actually see who's in the crowd because you're that intense on who you're trying to sort of slag off. And Obviously, Dr. Dre's in there somewhere, mingling among the crowd. I mean, when did you notice Dr. Dre was actually taking notice of you? Because he came from one of the biggest rap bands ever, NWA. So,
well, as you said, it's very intense, and you don't really get much opportunity to look at the crowd because you're so focused on the person in front of you, like trying to break them down. So I didn't really notice that I was starting to gather some attention in my battles. Other than crowd reactions that I heard, I didn't really think there was much going on for me until I get the word from Dre. He stopped me outside a show, and he basically had a word with me, and it's all kind of kicking off from there.
I mean, you were a very, very small child when rap first exploded in the early 1980s with the Sugar Hill Gang, of course, and Grandmaster Melly Mel and such.
Yeah.
I mean, you're from a musical city anyway, Detroit, the sound of Motown, and the Detroit city and all that. Who were your early influences, would you say, musically?
I'd say definitely my early influences came from a lot of Motown. My parents weren't around for me a lot when I was growing up, obviously, so I didn't inherit much of kind of the old school town, you know, sound from that. It was mostly from the people around me, and the people around me were all into the old school hip hop, from Sugar Hill Gang to Grandmaster Flash, and all those different old school hip hop influences kind of came into one. And I wanted to take a more disturbed vibe on it. I wanted to take it a bit more crazy. I wanted to take it a bit more, bring it to life a bit more than it was, rather than just being cool. I wanted it to express emotions a lot more.
I mean, it's a wonderful city, Detroit. It's quite a hard working class city. But what we were going to do, we're going to come back to you shortly, because there's so much I want to discuss with you. I mean, you're such a complex character, which I'm sure our viewers would love to know more about you, which we will be doing very shortly. So sit tight there for us, Marshall, if I can call you that. Right, we're going to have to cut that into you short now, but don't go anywhere, because we'll be asking more questions to the great Eminem after the short news report.
Hello and welcome to today's Time Tunnel News with me, Natalie Wayne. The main headlines from the year 2000 were the USS Cole bombing, slipping through security in the small boat, terrorists carry out a suicide explosive attack on the US Navy destroyer USS Cole in Yemen, killing 17 sailors. The coal base at Norfolk was en route to the Persian Gulf to enforce a UN trade embargo against Iraq. US multinational corporations are walloped by rising oil prices that surged to more than $30 a barrel, increasing costs for manufacturers and transporters and reducing profits. Western nations persuaded Saudi Arabia and several oil-producing nations to condemn rising prices as harmful to the world economy. President Bill Clinton orders the release of oil from the nation's emergency reserve in an effort to stabilise gasoline prices, which rose to more than $1.60 a gallon. America was divided after 8 years of President Bill Clinton, but it was not until the vote tally started rolling in on the night of November the 7th, 2000, that the nation's narrow split came sharply into colour. The cliffhanger election of Texas Gov. George W. Bush over Vice President Al Gore in the presidential race added the terms red state and blue state to the lexicon and set the stage for a decade of rancorous and at times paranoid politics. Gore prevailed in the national popular vote, but Bush won where it mattered, in the Electoral College, thanks to his carrying of the crucial swing state, Florida, by a mere 537 votes, a margin far tighter than in a typical mayoral or legislative race. It was not that clear-cut, of course. With the stakes so high and the race so close, Democrats and Republicans dug in for a protected fight that eventually would lead to the US Supreme Court. Early the morning after the polls closed, Gore called Bush to concede and hastily took it back. Florida would have a recount. For our next story, we cut to Lewis Morris, who is outside HMV.
Second ever album, the Marshall Mathers LP. Fans may currently be excited about the new hit album, but will they be so pleased when they hit play? Reports have come in with the release of this album that people are hating on Eminem's lyrics, in particular songs, where he is rude towards other celebrities. The first single released from the album, called The Real Slim Shady, he states, among other things, that Christina Aguilera performed oral sex on Fred Durst and Carson Daly. This obviously caused some controversy between fans and the music industry. All I can say is there is a lot of atmosphere here as thousands of the record are getting sold. This is Lewis Morris, reporting from Oxford Road, London. Back to you in the studio.
Thanks, Lewis. A federal judge orders Microsoft Corp split into two, declaring the software giant an untrustworthy monopoly that refuses to abandon illegal business practices that crush competitors and harm consumers. The ruling world would have set in motion the largest forced reorganisation of a corporation since the breakup of Standard Oil in 1911. The Justice Department later decides against breaking up Microsoft and seeks a lesser antitrust penalty. In other news, Eminem releases the Marshall Mathers LP. The Marshall Mathers LP is the third studio album by American rapper Eminem. It was released on May the 23rd in 2000 by Interscope Records in the United States and on September the 11th, 2000 by Polydor Records in the United Kingdom. The album was produced mostly by Dr. Dre and Eminem, along with the 45 King, Beige Brothers and Mailman. The album sold more than 1.76 million copies in the US in the first week alone, becoming the fastest selling studio album by any artist in America music history. In 2001, the album won the Grammy Award for the Best Rap Album and was nominated for the Album of the Year. The album was certified Diamonds by the Recording Industry Association of America in 2011 for shipping 10 million copies in the United States. Since its release in 2000, the album sold 10,766,000 copies in the United States and more than 21 million copies worldwide. The Marshall Mathers LP has been ranked as one of the greatest hip-hop albums of all time by Rolling Stone, Time and XXL. Rolling Stone placed the album at number 7 on its list of the best albums of the 2000s. The album was ranked number 244 by Rolling Stone on their list of the 500 greatest albums of all time. In 2010, Rhapsody ranked it on number 1 on the 10 best albums of white rappers list. That's all from Time Tunnel News. Thank you and goodbye.
OK, thanks very much for that, Natalie. We are now going to have another chat with the worldwide phenomenon that is Eminem phenomenon. Sorry, I had to throw that in. LL Cool J and all that business. Right, so as we were talking about your upbringing, you do mention an awful lot of your childhood within the first two albums, of course, the Slim Shady LP plus Marshall Mathers, which has just been released now. So, Kim, that's your mother, she takes a heck of a beating, doesn't she, in your lyrics?
Yeah, she's not one of my favourite characters from my life by a long shot, so yeah, everything I could to, you know, take a swing at her in my early lyrics, yes, I did.
Is it just deserved, is it, do you think, the treatment she gave you?
What kind of mother is on drugs when your child is in the kitchen with nothing to eat? That's the real state of it. I'd never do that to my children, so why should I accept it from her?
I mean, what your father as such, what happened to him? I mean, obviously we don't hear an awful lot about your father in a lot of your lyrics. Yep. Your mother definitely takes the flak.
I suppose the reason you don't hear a lot about my father is because I never really knew a lot about my father. He left before I really got a chance to, you know, get to grips with him as a person. So, yeah, I don't honestly respect him for walking out on me, but honestly, I can't comment him as a person because I didn't know him.
I mean, around the time you were born, I mean, the world was going through a massive recession, as we all know, and you fought through it. How were your school years? I mean, what led you on to music and rap as such? Because obviously, you were only 8, 9 years of age when rap became a phenomenon in the world, worldwide stage, if you like. So what drew you to it?
Obviously, loneliness took a big part of my childhood. My mum was never there, and I never fit in at school. I was always the sick-minded kid in the back of the classroom. I didn't really go for that. So music kind of became my outlet, and rap became my outlet, definitely. And it shows in my music because I'm often taking out frustrations, and that started at a very early age to take out frustrations into music.
I mean, so in the latter 1990s, you're doing the rap battles. Did that start at school, and then did it just progress from there? And rap and hip hop, and you know, everything became worldwide. You know, I mean, did you sort of think, right, I can do this? Who was the first person you saw doing this sort of thing, shouting these obscenities through lyrics? I mean, amazing.
I suppose it was some older kids at school when I was really, really young. I saw some older kids, like, you know, hanging out and beatboxing, giving it a little bit of boom.
A little
bit of that, a little MCing, you know, out by the courtyard, and I was just like, I want to get into that, because they were letting themselves free, they were letting themselves go. Everyone else was walking around pretending to be someone that they're not. At least they were expressing themselves.
I mean, now we're in the year 2000. I mean, like you say, it has become an actual art form. And when you think about it, you know, you've got all these very sort of clever people who were sort of slagging hip hop and rap off at first, but you've got to think on your feet very quickly. I mean, not just to rhyme certain words together, they've got to make sense as well.
Yeah.
Is this just done on top of your head? So if I was to say, sing a song about a glass bottle, you could actually just start thinking, and everything would just keep flashing across your mind? And
of course, things come easier when you're thinking about them. Like, emotions will always come easier into your lyrics. But say if I had to rap about a glass bottle, you know, you could take any kind of swing on those words. It doesn't have to be the same letters, just the same syllable count. So glass bottle could rhyme to ass bubble, or fat gobble, or snap cobble. You know, it's just anything like that.
Yeah.
Anything
but
like that.
It's just so amazing. I mean, and also, apart from your own family members taking a beating by your lyrics, you've actually sort of slagged off politicians, fellow pop stars. There was one lyric about one of our musical greats here, Moby. He said, 36, too old, get over it, and all that business. And, you know, it's just so amazing. And Christina Aguilera's took a bit of flack from you. I mean, what is it about sort of those, are they sort of manufactured to you, people like Christina Aguilera, Britney Spears, Justin Timberlake?
I've grown up with a lot of hatred for pop culture. It's been embedded in my veins. I can never relate to it when I was young, and I think a lot of people still don't relate to it now. So I think the more I can express my distaste for it, the more I can identify with my target audience, which are people like me.
I mean, like I say, you really hit the world stage in 1999 with, of course, My Name Is, which is where I was introduced to you, really. And then it went on from there. And it's very interesting the way you've got your name together. You've used your initials, M&M, and it's amazing. I like what you've done there with From Marshall Mathers. Do you think that sounded a bit better than saying, right, live on stage, Marshall Mathers? And you thought to yourself, hang on a minute, that sounds a bit...
Yeah, I always hated my name. That's the first reason I've probably hated my mom ever since birth, just that name.
Marshall, yeah. I mean, you will always be known to us as M&M now. I mean, that's as simple as that. What we're going to do very shortly, we're going to talk about the up-and-coming film that you're putting together called 8 Mile. We'll go into all that. Various other musical tastes and interests that you've had. And, of course, about the great rap battles, East v West, Snoop Dogg, Biggie Smalls, Tupac and all that. We'll be coming back to that very, very shortly. So sit tight for us again there, once again, M&M. We've reached the end of that particular interesting segment of the show, but don't worry, we'll be back with a final load of questions for this man here straight after this break. See you in two. Straight back, and here we are with this very interesting guest and an interesting chat. We'll continue where we left off with M&M. Right, as I mentioned just before the break there, there's been an awful lot of rivalry, and it's not just about the volleying of words. There's been volleying of bullets, hasn't there, as well? Yeah. I mean, you've not really been caught up in all that, and neither's Dr. Dre, but if we go back sort of 5 or 6 years to Biggie Smalls, Tupac, what is going on there with all this business, with all this...
Well, rappers always been associated with gang culture, and a lot of the great rappers have come in. They've not started, you know, on their own. They've started from gangs, and it's more a message of where they've come from that leads up to those things. It's not really as much as what they say in the media. It's more about their backgrounds and who would be against that background from the moment they see them. So at the same time, you can't really blame people for that, you know, for wanting to hate something that they've grown up hating. And it really, we do need to, you know, lay down our arms and just say enough is enough. Like, we can't have any more bloodshed that would end well. But it's really just a message of where we've come from. It's always been associated with gang culture.
I mean, there's an awful lot of lyrics and an awful lot of songs like Ice Cube's Yo, Check Yourself, Self, which actually pulled out the message by Grandmaster Flash, and he put a load of lyrics on that Yo, Check Yourself from the East v West sort of battle. And the 1994 classic album Dr. Dre, The Chronic, there was an awful lot of sort of volleying of words there about the hatred of East v West and so on and so forth. You've sort of kept yourself away from that in a way. You've more or less concentrated on your own personal experiences, haven't you? And one of the songs that you just released at the moment, Stan, where you met the wonderful lady singer from these shores, Dido.
Yeah.
I mean, Stan, did that actually happen?
That did actually happen. That is a true story. It's a story that's very close to me, and it's very heartbreaking. Obviously, the video was dramatized to make it look, you know, to make it fit into a 3-minute video and to get a very, very clear and, you know, unmessed around message out. But the basis of the storyline is very correct.
It's amazing. You know, I'd love to talk about your new film, which is out very shortly. It's called 8 Mile. Hopefully you can join us before the film's out in a couple of years. You'll be back here and you can talk a bit more about that then. So sorry about that, but unfortunately that's all we have time for on the Time Tunnel TV. Once again, thanks very much for your company. Thanks for Eminem for coming in today and performing for us. And we look forward to his next performance. He's just getting himself ready up there. So once again, thanks to you guys out there. Look forward to seeing you next time around on another interesting deluge into time with the Time Tunnel. In the meantime, Mr. Marshall Mathers, otherwise known as Eminem. Take it away, kid.
May I have your attention, please? May I have your attention, please? Will the real Slim Shady please stand up? I repeat, will the real Slim Shady please stand up? We're gonna have a problem here.
Act like you never seen a white person before. Jaws all on the floor like Pam, like Tommy just burst in the door. Started whooping her ass first than before. They first were divorced, sewing her over furniture. It's the return of the...
Oh, wait, no, wait, you're kidding. He didn't just say what I think he did he?
And Dr. Dre said... Nothing, you idiots. Dr. Dre's dead. He's locked in my basement. Feminist women love Eminem.
Chicka, 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 Slim Shady. I'm sick of him. Look at him walking around, grabbing his you know what, flipping the you know who. Yeah, but he's so cute, though.
Yeah, I probably got a couple of screws up in my head loose. But no worse than what's going on in your parents' bedrooms. Sometimes I want to get on TV and just let loose, but can't. But it's cool for Tom Green to hump a dead moose. My bum is on your lips. My bum is on your lips. And if I'm lucky, you might just give it a little kiss. And that's the message that we deliver to little kids. And expect them not to know what a woman's. Is. Of course they're gonna know what intercourse is. By the time they hit fourth grade, they got the Discovery Channel, don't they? We ain't nothing but mammals. Well, some of us cannibals who put other people open like cantaloupes. But if we can hunt dead animals and antelopes, then there's no reason that a man and another man can't elope. But if you feel like I feel, I got the antidote. Women, wave your pantyhose, sing the chorus, and it goes.
I'm Slim Shady, yes, I'm the real Shady. All you other Slim Shadys are just imitating. So won't the real Slim Shady please stand up? Please stand up, please stand up. Cause I'm Slim Shady, yes, I'm the real Shady. All you other Slim Shadys are just imitating. So won't the real Slim Shady please stand up? Please stand up, please stand up.
Will Smith don't got a cuss in his raps to sell records. Well, I do, so f*** him and you too. You think I give a damn about a Grammy? Half of you critics can't even stomach me, let alone stand me.
But Slim, what if you win? Wouldn't it be weird?
Why? So you guys can just lie to get me here, so you can sit me here next to Britney Spears? Christina Aguilera better switch me chairs, so I can sit next to Carson Daly and Fred Durst and hear him argue over who she gave to first. Little put me on blast on MTV.
Yeah, he's cute, but I think he's married to Kim.
I said download her audio on MP3 and show the whole world how you gave him an M. I'm sick of you little girl and boy groups. All you do is annoy me, so I have been sitting here to destroy you. And there's a million of us just like me, who cuss like me, who just don't give a f*** like me, who dress like me, walk, talk, and act like me. And just might be the next best thing, but not quite me.
I'm Slim Shady, yes, I'm the real Shady. All you other Slim Shadys are just imitating. So won't the real Slim Shady please stand up? Please stand up, please stand up. Cause I'm Slim Shady, yes, I'm the real Shady. All you other Slim Shadys are just imitating. So won't the real Slim Shady please stand up? Please stand up, please stand up.
I'm like a head trip to listen to, cause I'm only giving you things you joke about with your friends inside your living room. The only difference is I got the balls to say it in front of y'all, and I don't gotta be false or sugarcoated at all. I just get on a mic and spit it, and whether you like to admit it, I just better than 90% of you rappers out, kid. Then you wonder how can kids eat up these albums like. It's funny, cause at the rate I'm going when I'm 30, I'll be the only person in a nursing home flirting, pinching nurses' asses when I'm for Jergens and I'm jerking, but this whole bag of Viagra isn't working, and every single person is a Slim Shady lurking. He could be working at Burger King, spitting on your onion rings, or in the parking lot circling, screaming I don't give a f- with his windows down and the system up. So will the real Shady please stand up and put one of those fingers on each hand up and be proud to be out of your mind and out of control. And one more time, loud as you can, how does it go?
I'm Slim Shady, yes I'm the real Shady. All you other Slim Shadys are just imitating. So won't the real Slim Shady please stand up? Please stand up, please stand up. Cause I'm Slim Shady, yes I'm the real Shady. All you other Slim Shadys are just imitating. So won't the real Slim Shady please stand up? Please stand up, please stand up. I'm Slim Shady, yes, I'm the real Shady. All you other Slim Shadys are just imitating. So won't the real Slim Shady please stand up? Please stand up, please stand up. Cause I'm Slim Shady, yes, I'm the real Shady. All you other Slim Shadys are just imitating. So won't the real Slim Shady please stand up? Please stand up, please stand up.
Guess there's a Slim Shady in all of us.